Hey, hey, welcome to my little talk. My name is Kian Forreal. I do traditional Japanese style tattoos here in Sydney. I've been tattooing about 20 years all over the world. I haven't actually worked in Japan, but I've been there several times, studied the culture, and worked with Western Japanese tattoo masters like Henning Jorgensen, Trevor McStay, John the Dutchman out of Canada, Gregory out of Holland. So I've been doing Japanese tattooing solely for about the last 10 years. And this little presentation is just a basic history of Japanese tattooing, how it relates to woodblock prints, how the woodblock prints were used as reference for tattooing, and that evolved into the tattooing that we see today. And then some other stuff on preserved skins and what some of the designs mean. Alright, so we'll get started by looking at traditional hand-puck Japanese. This is a bodysuit by Horitoshi out of Tokyo. So this is all done by hand. The outline's by machine, but all the color, shading, background, everything hand-poked. And very meticulously hand-poked. This kind of stuff, that might be 100, 150 hours of tattooing. It doesn't go very quickly. He uses a short stick method, which is about this big. And it's just very, 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 I've been tattooed by him, and it's very time-consuming. It's another bodysuit by the same artist. You see very heavy use of black, and this is what distinguishes Japanese tattooing, is the heavy black background and the very simple, elegant simplicity, if you will, of the motifs. Nothing too fancy, not a lot of textures, just real simple, strong tattooing. This is the front view. This is one. This is Horiyoshi II out of Tokyo as well. This is probably from 1940, 1950. Again, all hand-poked. The female. Back piece bodysuit. I'm not sure the artist, I just really like the photo. This is Horiyoshi 3. So you can sort of see the style that we're talking about. Not the softer style. This is the hard, real traditional, heavy black Japanese style. Another one more Horiyoshi 3 bodysuit. So the earliest record they have of tattooing in Japan is these little clay statues that they found in all these tombs and archaeological digs. They're little clay figurines called haniwa. And these haniwa appear to have tattoo markings on their faces and on their bodies. They're not entirely sure what they meant, what significance these statues have. They're more like little honorary statues, so maybe they were for mystical or magical purposes or some sort of ritualistic thing. But they're pretty sure that they're tattoos and they represent little tattoo deities of some sort. You can see here the haniwa statues. And on the right, you'll see the face markings on different various statues found in different tombs. And one more little statue there. So the earlier record of Japan, apart from the statues, they have record of tattooing being used like in the 5th century AD as marks to show social rank. Sort of like in the similar to the Maori culture. So they have swirls or lines to show how high they're up in society. Apart from that, there's not a lot of talk about it. The Chinese have records of going to Japan and encountering a tattooed people. But again, it's all just very basic. We saw tattoos and there's no other record of what they meant or what they were. Now, tattooing sort of disappeared for a while after that, and there's not a lot of record of it until it started being used later on in the late 800s as punitive tattooing. So they were marking criminals. Not a lot, but if there was a criminal that, say, did something heinous yet not worthy of death, perhaps was a rapist or a child fiddler and that kind of thing at the time, they would mark their foreheads or their arms with marks so that people would see them coming and know that they were bad people. So different areas would have different marks. So some of the spots would be like the different ideograms on the forehead. One might say dog, one might say thief, right? Now in a culture like Japan that is so socially intertwined and such a sense of community and a sense of belonging, to have tattoos like this would be very much an ostracization from every facet of society. So it was like a living death, not being able to really commune with anybody in your whole country. So it wasn't a very desirable thing to have these tattoos. Now the word irezumi, ire means to poke or to inject, and zumi is the ink, the charcoal stick. You've heard of sumi painting, sumi ink. So that's from this. The word irezumi originally meant punitive tattoo. It was the punishment tattoo that they would call. So the sentence would be, you were to be tattooed with irezumi. So at the time, the pictorial tattooers later on, in the same period, would not use the word irezumi because it had a negative connotation to it. They'd use the word horimono, which means carved object. And they'd call themselves horishi, which was a carver, similar to the woodblock print. We'll get onto that in a second. So then we have irebopuru. Now, after the punitive tattooing, that kind of died out in the early 1700s. And this kind of tattooing kind of took over. And that was pledge marks or love marks between like a courtesan and her favorite client, or the priest and the accolades, or just any sort of two lovers that liked each other a lot. They'd get maybe a little symbol for love, and then the person's name tattooed on their thigh or on their breast to show their undying devotion to them. And this kind of tattoo was very popular. It was used in the literature, in the arts. You can see these are woodblock prints showing a courtesan tattooing her lover, or her patron. Right? So this type of tattoo was very popular, and it got the attention of the authorities. Now, in a country like Japan, which was a very, very strict military dictatorship, every facet of society was governed and controlled. And tattooing was the same. So they put a thing that you couldn't get tattoos anymore. So this kind of stuff died out a little bit. Now, how we got to the big bodysuit tattoos is kind of the mystery of what this whole thing is about. How did it go from little love marks to full bodysuits? And those pictures I showed you, that was the same kind of style of tattooing being done 200 years ago. So we ask ourselves, what happened? Now, some people say that they used punitive marks for denoting criminals, and they used pictorial tattoos to cover those marks. So if you look at a lot of traditional tattooing, you'll see that there's big gaps on the inside of the arm here. These are tattoos that I've done, and I follow this tradition. So, the reason they left these was to show for the wearer of the decorative tattoo that they were in fact not criminals. And they could run around, and if somebody accused them of hiding their punishment marks, they could say, no, I'm not a criminal, I'm just wearing a decorative tattoo. Now this whole time that this all started to happen, a period called the Tokugawa or the Edo period, also known as the Tokugawa Shogunate, between 1603 and 1868. This was a time when the Shogun unified Japan from being a feudal country with lots of warring feudal states. This is where the samurai arose from, constantly fighting each kingdom and fiefdom, fighting each other for control, territory, money, and power. What the Shogun did was bring the whole country unified, so there was no more war. It came at a sort of a time of relaxation and peace for the first time in a long time. It was also a time when Japan was totally isolated from the rest of the world. Foreigners were not allowed to go there. You could not trade with Japan. If you say you're shipwrecked and you washed ashore on Japan, they would kill you. That was it. There was no, oh, we'll help you out and get you back to your country. Even if you tried to come there to make a trade or something, they would pretty much cut your head off. So it was entire isolation. So that's what allowed the culture and the arts to flourish, totally uncontaminated from the West. We'll see later how that changed, but for now, this was the period where there was totally just Japan for Japan. This is what developed this style of tattooing. Now at the time when this happened, when it became the United Japan, before that it was a very a rice-based economy. There's no money, it was just rice. So the samurai owned all the land, and the people worked the land, and paid their taxes, and paid their rent, and paid for their labor in rice. And they got to keep a little bit of what they grew for themselves, and trade amongst other people for things. But the rest of it was given to the landlords and to the government. So, at the time, there was no middle class. There was the rich, the samurai, the nobility who ran everything. And there was the poor, who were the laborers, the commoners, the peasants, the workers, and they had nothing. And they weren't even allowed to wear nice clothes. Even if you had a little bit of scratch, you couldn't wear a nice kimono in public. You'd be punished for it. So what happened was, when Japan unified, they basically, the farmers started to diversify their crops a little bit, started to plant two crops a year instead of one, and they started to use, money was created so they could trade with cash instead of rice. And then the middle class emerged out of this. So a middle class farmer became a merchant class. They became a little bit of the bourgeois middle class. They had money, yet they still had no rights. They were still considered the lowest class. So they weren't allowed to dress nice. What they would do is, they would wear very plain kimonos on the outside, but the inside would have the brocades and the silks and the fancy designs so they could feel good about themselves, but they couldn't flaunt it in public. Right? This kind of stuff, right? Now, people say that this is what tattooing evolved from, is that you got these full body suits to flaunt your wealth, yet you couldn't wear the nice clothes. Not entirely true. I mean, I'm sure it happened from time to time, but the people that were getting tattoos were the lower class. They weren't the bourgeois middle class. They weren't the merchants, and they weren't the rich people. Tattooing is and always has been in Japan, as in most places, a lower class pastime. Not to say a low class bad thing, but just it was an art form of the commoners. Right? So it wasn't the rich people trying to rebel against the government. It was the poor people or the common people doing what they wanted to do, and them maybe flaunting it out. Now, where it really took off was in the Yoshiwara Pleasure District in Tokyo. This is the gates. So this was like a little walled city within a city. And if you were locked in there at night, you had to stay the night. There was only one way in and out. This was a little red painted place, just like I said, the floating world, right? So there was brothels, bathhouses, tea houses, courtesans, and this is where the geisha became the geisha. This is where they became legendary status. If you've seen the movie Memoirs of a Geisha, it happened in this place. Right? So a lot of the people, the prostitutes and the people who worked there, they couldn't leave. They were basically indentured slaves to the landowners in this place. But this is where tattooing kind of grew, flourished, because they also had Kabuki theater in there. And Kabuki theater was like it replaced the no theater of the imperial, the rich people. But that was very, like, what we would call an opera in this day. And Kabuki was more like TV. You know, it was more like something that poor people could relate to, stories that people could relate to, things that were happening at the time, this kind of thing. This is like the print of the inside of Kabuki theater. So you can see it's very big and very popular. And all the masks, you know, you see a lot of those in the face paint come from Kabuki theater. You can see here, this is Kabuki paint and then also replicated in the prints. Now, at the time, what was happening was they were using the prints and the Kabuki were kind of feeding off each other. Right? So because printmaking was very cheap, they would often use it in advertising for certain plays or for certain brothels. And this immortalized many of the famous courtesans, many of the famous actors of the time, you can see here. If you look at like a lot of the Udomaro prints, these were all basically courtesans that it was making prints of at the time. Now, so, at the time, as we said, the samurai weren't fighting anymore. And what they became was, instead of the gallant warrior of yesteryear that everybody revered and worshipped, they kind of became a bit of an oppressive part of the country. They were the ones who were really pushing down on the poor people because they were idle. There was 400,000 samurai families that didn't produce a single thing. All they did was own land and force people to work on it. So the poor people, the workers, were really sick of it. They weren't revering these people as gods anymore. And the code of the samurai that we all know, Bushido, it's filtered its way down through the culture. So like your employer, employee, landlord, tenant, all these things had that same lord and vassal kind of feel to it. You had to obey your superiors, right? So they, you know, like, really were used to that, but then when their superiors started to turn on them, I mean, you imagine samurai were warriors, ready to die at a moment's notice. They had no wars to fight. So what did they do? They became idle and they became corrupt. These corrupted the samurai. And there was no laws restricting them at all. They could basically cut down a commoner in the street just to test a sword and nothing would happen to them. So they were very much vilified and all the classes turned on the samurai at this point in time. So you had this other group of people called the Otokodate. Now the Otokodate were what you would call vigilantes. They were common people, shopkeepers, merchants, workers, and they would protect the common people from, you know, roaming bands of samurai. Right? And they were put into the prince, you can see here, and they were heavily tattooed. We can tell the Otokodate because they only carry one sword. In all the prints of samurais, the samurais have two swords, and that's the differentiation. So prior to this Edo period, the samurais were the heroes. And you can see in some of the earlier woodblock prints, the samurais were very much the center of attention when it came to warrior prints. So apart from the Otokodate, we have another group of people that were the new heroes of Japan. So we had the vigilantes and we had the firemen, who were called the Hikeshi. And the Hikeshi as well were very much into tattoos. You can see here, this is a woodblock print of a Hikeshi with two sleeves, probably a back piece and chest plates. And this is the standard that they would carry. Each fire company had their own 3D sort of paper mache logo that they carry on a stick. They were basically gangs. The firemen were gangs of ruffians hired by the government to be on patrol for fires. In a massive city that was basically made of paper and wood and bamboo, a small little fire from a cooking stove could burn down the entire city. So their job was to patrol around. If there was a fire, they'd run around and they'd break down all the houses around the fire so the fire couldn't spread. But on top of that, they're usually fighting each other as well, because they're basically street thugs who were employed as firemen. They often used a dragon as their tattoo. Like, a lot of them have the same tattoos and their same gangs. Because a dragon, which lives in air and water, was apparently impervious to flame. But these guys would be fighting fire sometimes in just a little fudoshi loincloth and a pair of flip-flops trying to fight fires. Good example of like a dragon that being someone who's best might have. So the kabuki plays that we talked about would often depict stories of the Otokodate fighting the samurai, fighting some oppressive person in the area. And the stories would be about the Otokodate standing up and protecting the commoners, protecting the women, and killing whoever these tyrants were. So they were heavily tattooed. So the young men of the day, instead of revering the samurai, they revered these guys. And in all these prints and in all these plays, the kabuki plays, they'd be having fake tattoos painted on them. And they, you know, the final scene to go to kill the samurai, they'd whip off their kimono and have a bodysuit tattooed on them. So the young people, the way kids of today look at TV and want to be a rap star and get their tattoos, it was the same thing back then, but it was kabuki plays. So all the young tough guys, even if they weren't gangsters or gamblers, they would get tattoos, say like a flower or a dragon, but like big scale stuff, right? You can see in a lot of the prints, you know, dragons, falcons, featured very heavily. These are prints of Otokodate, and you can tell it because they have one sword. Here's a print of a fire in Edo. You can see, well, these are the Hikeshi. Sometimes when they were fighting fires, they would wear these really thick woolen jackets that were soaked in water when they were getting right up close to the flames. And then the rest of the time they take it off and just get in their fundoshi and their thongs. A little bit dark. You can see here he's got the three-quarter sleeve and two chest plates, and probably based on a real fireman at the time. They also did kabuki plays about firemen as well. Now, the thing we have to ask is, what really propelled Japanese tattooing into the mainstream? I mean, it was obviously in the pleasure districts and in the plays, and a certain culture tattoos were popular, but what really brought it into the entire mainstream of the Japanese culture, such a unified, such an imaginative art that up until this day it's really not even rivaled compared to the rest of the things that were going around at the time. And this was a book. It was a book from China called The 108 Heroes of the Sukadan, or The Water Margin. This was a Chinese novel about Sun Qiang and his gang of 108 heroes who were outlaws and brigands who fought against a corrupt Chinese bureaucracy. Now this was a book that apparently this stuff happened from 1117 to 1121 AD. The book was written in the 14th century and brought over to Japan at about 1750. And it was an instant classic. The Japanese translation, as soon as it hit the shelves, became an instant classic, because in a country that was so oppressed by the military dictatorship, to read a book that was about revolutionaries fighting the government and winning was like the people could live vicariously through these heroes in the story. And in the Chinese version, all these heroes had big bodysuit tattoos. And each of the stories, 108 stories, say 108 chapters, each hero has his own story of glory and courage and battle, and a lot of times how he died, either fighting a beast or fighting a tyrant. So for about 50 years, this book was a big seller. It captured everyone's imaginations, and it described the tattoos. So people would get these tattoos from the descriptions. In the early 1800s, Hokusai, some people might have heard of Hokusai, he was commissioned to do a series of prints for an illustrated version of the book that was slightly Japanified in the story, but not so much in the prints. But the thing is, at the time, the government couldn't allow a Japanese version of this book because it would be completely revolutionary to the government. Because it was a Chinese story, people would do, they could just say, it's just about another country, it's just a story. So it was allowed. And that was kind of like this loophole that allowed them to read a revolutionary manifesto in such a controlled and restricted place. So the Hope Society edition was the first edition to bring to life the characters from the book. And I can't overstate enough how important this book is to the Japanese tattooing that we know of today, that people around here are doing as we speak. These are a few more of the Hokusai prints. Now, these were black and white prints, or black and gray as you were, and not color, and not super detailed. Okay? So about 10 years after this edition, legendary Utagawa Kuniyoshi, he was commissioned to do a set of prints. Seven prints for an illustrated version. And these are the prints that he made. And they were in full color, showing the full bodysuit tattoos of these characters of the Sukudan. And this book is what, this version and these prints are what most, if not all, Japanese tattooing stem from in the traditional sense. Now, Kuniyoshi was a very, at the time, a fairly popular woodblock artist. This book and these prints propelled him to international or national acclaim at the time. Now he's probably the most famous and well-known woodblock artist of this period. But at the time, it made him a household name in Japan. So you can see here, these prints are 200 years old, almost. Full bodysuit tattoo. So if you have no TV, no internet, no movies, no color real artwork at all, and this stuff is the most popular stuff of the day, and all the guys, all the heroes, all the warriors of the time are covered in tattoos, if you're a young man or a woman who's looking to be more sexually attractive, that's what you're going to shoot towards, is being heavily tattooed. Right? Because that was all there pretty much was at the time. One more Kuniyoshi print. Now they say that Kuniyoshi himself was a tattooer. He was definitely heavy tattooed, probably had a back piece. There's literature that talks about that. The fact that he was a tattooer himself is quite possible. Like I said before, woodblock carving, so you'd have a block of wood, you have to carve the outline in it. This was done by guys known as Horishi. And Horishi is what the tattooers of the day called themselves. So it was the same name to do tattooing and carve the woodblocks. And it took the same amount of skill to do a similar process. So they say that a lot of woodblock carvers who weren't carving at the time started tattooing. It went back and forth. It was a very meshed sort of thing. But we'll get more onto that in a minute later. So Kuniyoshi, if he was a tattooer, you can see this back. A lot of his prints, and if you look at them when you get home on the internet, they all have a split down the middle in order to facilitate being put very large as a back piece. All of his prints are like this. And we'll see later some examples of his prints directly copied as traditional Japanese back pieces. Here's another one here. I mean, I've seen that as a back piece before, and you can see if this comes down to one buttock and that comes down to the other, it's a perfect size, but you can have it fill the whole back. Here's a perfect example here. Again, it's a little bit dark, I'm sorry. You can see this gentleman here, full body suit of tattoos, translated perfectly as a back piece of the space. Here's another one here. Exact copy. Dragon Warrior. Orokodate. One of the 108 heroes of the Sukudan fighting a tiger. This is a Japanified version, translated. So, in 1854, after all this isolation, the Americans showed up at Edo Port. They come and they said, let us in, we want to trade with you, we want to see what you have in your country. And for the last 100 years, Japan had been saying no. But finally, when they showed up with 4 armed warships and threatened to level the entire city. Now, a city made of cardboard and paper is no match against 4 heavily armed American warships full of guns. So the Japanese relented, and they made a treaty, and they let the Americans come. And this was still at the end of the Tokugawa period, right? So, at this time, tattooing, like I might have mentioned before, maybe not enough, tattooing was illegal. You weren't allowed to get tattooed. I mean, people still did it, but you weren't allowed to do it. It was very much frowned upon, and they kind of had to be a little bit hush-hush. People flaunted their tattoos, But still, if they were caught and the tattoos were caught, oftentimes every maybe 20 years, they'd make a new law and they'd come and ban their books and they'd take their stuff and they'd put them in jail for a little while, try and teach them a lesson. It didn't work, but they tried. So when the Americans came in, then the Dutch came in, then the English came in, and everybody came in, and the first thing they would see when they got off the boat was usually a porter wearing a fundoshi, grabbing their luggage and putting it onto a cart. And that porter would be heavily tattooed, full body suit. And all the literature of the early visitors to Japan talk about these people having their whole bodies painted. So the porters, the palanquin bearers, everybody, the construction workers were known for working in a loincloth and thongs, working on buildings, full body suit tattoos. So it was everywhere, the entire culture. Now, when the Japanese realized that some of their stuff was maybe a little bit not the same as the West, like they used to have big phallic penises everywhere in the cities for fertility worship, they got a little bit self-conscious and they started tearing all this stuff down and trying to westernize the country and make it a little less, you know, strange. And tattooing was something they considered barbaric. These are the upper classes. So they outright banned tattooing again. So what was funny is you had, the Japanese weren't allowed to get tattooed, but the foreigners were. And you can see here, what looks like a British gentleman getting a hand poke tattoo by a Japanese tattoo master in Nagasaki. So they weren't getting the massive tattoos, but they were getting the small ones. This is a statuette of what you might see when you get off the boat with a couple of guys sporting around the geisha. So, when the Meiji Registration started in 1869, that was when the full westernization of Japan happened. So it was the end of the shogunate, and it was a time of industrialization, so to speak. And they definitely, that's when they had it with tattooing. They would go around, they were rounding up the tattooers, arresting them, burning all their pattern books, stealing all their stuff. And basically, tattooers had to go completely underground, which is what us traditionally still have of tattooers usually working out of their houses, or small little studios and apartment buildings with no signs, no signage, no websites, all very, very hush-hush. It's a little bit different now, but up until about 15 years ago, it was still like that. So, the foreigners, they were allowed to get tattooed, so they could, you know, they could find these Japanese guys. A lot of the times, they would take the Japanese tattooer to Europe. There's records of them being contracted for a year or two at a time and going to Europe and tattooing the nobility. A lot of European nobility went to Japan to get tattooed. Princes, princesses, kings and queens all had tattoos. I know, you know, King Frederick of Denmark had a tattoo. A couple of the princes of England had tattoos. Some of these were done by Japanese tattoo masters. So the Japanese actually started advertising in guidebooks for the foreigners for when they came to Japan because it was so dangerous for them to tattoo the Japanese. So this, you know, went on. Obviously things softened up and people still got tattooed, but they had to start covering them up and keeping them just for themselves. Whereas in the before time, they were flaunting it quite a bit. Now it became more of a very private thing. So there's no hands, no faces, no necks. It was all just sleeves. And then, you know, you'd see with the open front so they could wear a kimono and it wouldn't show that they had a tattoo. So, now the face of Japanese tattooing today that most people associate with, maybe not us, but people that don't know anything about anything, is these guys. The Yakuza. Right? When you think Japanese tattooing, you think Japanese gangsters, right? And that's not an unfair thing to say, because they are known for their tattoos. Many movies have idealized them as noble gangsters, noble lower class, this kind of thing, right? So the Yakuza used to come from, they came from gambling gangs called the Bakuto. And the Bakuto were basically guys who ran gambling dens all throughout the country, a lot of the times in the pleasure districts, but also on the traveling roads, what's known as the 53 stations. So these guys would have little gambling houses, they'd be debt collectors, money lenders, and they had a very, very big tattoo culture. As you can see here, these aren't Yakuza, these are Bakuto, from maybe like the early 1900s, before the Yakuza were firmly the Yakuza. The other thing the Yakuza came from were the Tekiya. The Tekiya were like stall vendors. At a time where there wasn't a lot of, you know, superstores, there was lots of little markets sold. If any of you've been to Asia, we've seen little guys with carts and little markets and stuff. And these were basically the dudes who stood over all those guys and ran all the markets. So that didn't interfere with the gambling, but those guys were probably intertwined. And that's where the Yakuza say that they come from, is from these two groups of people. You know, the Yakuza, missing fingers, all that sort of thing, right? Now, here's a group there. Now, the Yakuza usually had their own tattoo families, so you couldn't just rock up to a Yakuza tattoo guy and go, hey, give me a bodysuit. You had to be part of the actual gang that was linked to the family, and it was there was a very strict code of how you spoke, how you talked to them, how you addressed them, how you acknowledged them. Very, very serious business. To be, at the time, I'm not sure now, but at the time, it was pretty much necessary to be fully or heavily tattooed to be in the gangs. As a sign of A, your dedication, and B, your courage to sit through the tattoo. It was very dishonorable not to finish your tattoo. You see here, example of something they might have. This would be looks like a samurai. A little bit more. So the other thing, I don't know if any of you guys know, but in Japan, if you are tattooed, you can't go to public bathhouses. You can't go to public swimming pools. And a lot of time you can't even go to a public gym if you're a tourist. Right? They have signs, as you see here, that will turn you away. So on a hot summer's day, if you're not at a Yakuza and have your own swimming pool, because they have their own bathhouses, and even though the people have to put up with them, they don't want to fraternize with them because they scare them. Tattoos scare the normal people that aren't tattooed in Japan. So you can't, like anyone here who's got a sleeve, you would not be welcome. They would strictly tell you, no tattoos, you can't come in. One day a year in Japan, there's a Shinto festival called the Sanjai Festival in Asakusa. And this is the one day that the Yakuza show their tattoos off. The rest of the time, it's just for them. They don't talk about it, they don't show it. They say that if you show your tattoos too much, they lose their power. So you keep them hidden, and you only show them when necessary. Except for on this one day when they carry these big shrines, and they run around, and they blow whistles, and they stand on them, and this is the one time of the year where you get to see. So if you go, this is happening May 18th to May 21st of every year, so you can go there and you can see this yourself. So we'll talk a little bit about the methods and the tools of early tattooing. I mean, this is a long time ago, right? It's a little bit different now, but we talked about the black. And this was the sumi. Now everything in Japanese tattooing stems from the sumi. The outlines are made from sumi, the background shading is made from sumi, the light shading is made from sumi. The sumi is basically a soot or a charcoal that was taken originally from the inside of lamps and lanterns. And it was ground down into a very, very fine powder and mixed with a glue that was rendered from cowhides. So this particular glue and soot mix, when flattened, let to harden, cure, then you took a stone, put a bit of water in it, you grind it, you get a very, very, very fine ink. Now depending on how diluted it was, would be whether it was dark or light or something in between. Now this, today, sumi has evolved into an art form in and of itself, with many houses, mostly based out of the south of Japan, Nara and Kyoto. Some of these sumi sticks you can see here might weigh an ounce or 2 ounces and fetch over $10,000. Some of the really fancy ones that the calligrapher, you see all the big Japanese paintings with the brushes, they all use these sticks. Now the Japanese tattooers at the time, you know, those of this day, the ones that do traditional style, they have to ground the ink every day because it goes off because it's glue and it's organic. You mix it with water and you grind it, you use it that day and you throw it out. And so every morning you have to grind your ink for the day, and it's a very slow and meticulous process. It might take you 2-3 hours a day to grind your ink just for that day. Now, the guys that I know that do this, you can put it in the fridge because they didn't have fridges back then. Now you can put it in the fridge, it might last 3 days. You put a little date on it and you know that in 3 days you're going to finish. But it's still it's just part of the tradition. Like guys like myself that made needles up until recently, every morning was your little ritual of making needles, and these guys made their needles and ground their ink. And these are the tools that they would use, which is basically a slender bamboo stick with some needles attached to the end. It's just a very slow poking process. And so the different groupings would be depending on whether you're doing big swaths of color, whether you're doing little fine lines, or even little bits of color. It's all from 42 needles to 3 needles, depending on what you needed to do. This photo here, I'm not sure if it's a setup photo or not, but it's a very good photo. You see the design book, his little toolkit. This would be his little grinding stick and his little stone. And you can see here in the next photo a little more clearly the way that they would do it. They weren't using ink caps in those days. They were using a sumi brush, as you can see here. It would be dipped in the sumi and held between the fingers. And they would dip the needles into the brush to load up. And then they Okay, and when the ink ran out on the needles, and they dip it back into the brush, it's a very effective way. I mean, I've balanced ink caps on people's backs before, and it's not good when it falls over. So this was a really good way. Now they don't do it because obviously it's rather unhygienic, but at the time with no gloves and nothing like that, it didn't really matter. Horiyoshi III developed a way to make reusable sticks. And these are just copies of those, these are a photo of those. So the stainless steel where you can put the needle groupings in them, use them, unsolder them, sterilize them, and use them again, as opposed to having to make a new stick every time for each customer. He also got quite fancy with his handles. And you can see here some of the handles that were attached to the end of the needles. And it looks like a couple of them have little blades and daggers that come out of them, which is, I guess, kind of good if you have unruly customers or something. Black and white photo of the colors used, not very good, but you get the idea of the little ink pots. And at the time, there's only four colors used in Japan. Black, indigo, yellow, and red. Red was super poisonous. Red was made from green vitriol and iron sulfate. It was so toxic that you could only do small amounts at a time, or you get fever and swelling and incredible pain. So if you see old school Japanese tattoos of red, you know those guys suffered for it. It was called scarlet fever. You get a little bit of red, you'd have to go chill for 3 days. So you can only do, if you're doing it, say, a belly of a dragon, you only get a little bit done at a time. The yellow was made from like a vegetable pigment, and the indigo was made from boiling rags that had been dyed in indigo, and then you take that liquid and mix that with a transparent pigment made from safflower, and that would turn violet. And you mix a little bit of that with yellow, and that would make a light green. So it was very much a limited palette they had compared to what we have today with all the inks that we use. A Japanese tattoo studio at the time, as a lot of the traditional ones are now, were basically just small rooms with a mat on the floor, prints on the wall, maybe a big bookshelf. Now they might have a TV or a radio going. But it was a very quiet and peaceful and serene place. It wasn't like the big busy street shops with heavy metal playing and five people tattooing in one room. It was usually one room, one guy, and very quiet, and they'd just do their thing. Right? So the first tattoo that you would get would be the kame no ko, or the turtleback. This was what your bodysuit was based on. It was all about getting a bodysuit in those days, as it is now with the traditional people. It wasn't about getting a sleeve, then maybe getting another sleeve, and then maybe getting a back piece. It was about, you start off with your back piece and you build that. That sets the tone of what your bodysuit's gonna be. And that would be, as you can see, full back, neck, so just above the back of the knee, and ass and everything. Then you might add the hikei, which is the chest, and then bring down to the gobu. So this would bring you to half sleeves and half thigh. Now a lot of guys would stay here. That's probably the most conservative back bodysuit that was going at the time and still is. You had the unawari in the front so you could wear your kimono open. Nobody would know you're tattooed. You could have sleeves to here. And you could look like just a regular guy, but no idea that you have a full back piece with half sleeves. The next level was to go three quarters with a shishibu. And this was, as you can see, three-quarter on the legs, three-quarter on the arms, with the front open. So pretty much a little bit the same as the last one, but a little bit longer. Then we have the Tsushinbori, which is full sleeves, full legs, and still with the front. So you could still be, with long sleeves down, a little bit discreet. If you wanted to go fully hardcore, you went with the Donburi Tsushinbori, with the long sleeve, long legs, and the front totally filled in. And that's pretty much the extent of what traditional tattooing was. You would never get your neck or your hands or your face tattooed at the time. It was all about being able to cover what you had. So no matter how great your tattooing was, how much you paid for it, how much you suffered, how great the artwork, it died with you. There was no way to pass it on. At the time, there wasn't even really cameras. So this one doctor, Dr. Fukushi, he was a mole specialist. He was trying to figure out how moles, the pigment in moles, moved within the skin. So that brought him to tattooing. He looked at tattooing and saw how the tattoo pigment moved into the skin as well. So he started hanging out with tattoo people, working in a clinic in Tokyo where he encountered a lot of tattoo people. This is like the 1920s. And now he was saying everyone was tattooed at the time. This is before the war. So he made friends with these people and he studied them and they took him around to meet the tattoo artist. He was very good friends with Horiyoshi I, who was working in Tokyo at the time. And Dr. Fukushi he was distraught with these beautiful works of art because he came to love the artwork. As an outsider who wasn't tattooed himself, he was very much enamored with the folk art and with the attention to detail and the care and the perseverance these people had, because he wasn't a low class. He was a doctor, so he was educated and maybe a little more switched on than the average construction worker at the time. So he wanted to find a way to preserve this art for later generations. So he ended up helping these people preserve their skins by them donating their skin to him. Right? You can see here, full bodysuit with hands and seams, which is strange, and feet fully skinned on the wall. Now, he did this with their full consent. They donated their skins because he worked for the medical university in Tokyo. And the collection is still there. They reckon he's collected over 105 skins that are still on, well, they're not on public display, but apparently you can go there and make an appointment, and if you have a good enough reason, maybe you're doing an article or something, they'll let you see some of the skins and stuff like this, right? So once he started collecting these skins, people thought, you know, hey, this guy really cares. So he started throwing little tattoo conventions in bathhouses. So once a year, he'd have a little tattoo gathering, and dudes would come in their little loincloths, and he'd walk around and check their artwork and see how things were going. I mean, these tattoos took like 10 years to get a bodysuit. So every year, he'd see their progress, and maybe mentally going, I'm going to have that on my wall one day. It's very possible, right? They say that as people got sicker, they got poor, or things happened, he would actually lend them money or give them money to finish their tattoos, A, so they could keep their honor, and B, so they were perhaps indebted to him and would leave their skins to him in the end. Now, he didn't collect just any skins. He only collected works of art. So all the skins he got were usually minimum the full box bodysuit, or at least a turtle back with the half sleeves. He wasn't collecting just small one-point tattoos at all. And it's very good that we have these photos. Very few photos of this actually happened. There's about three or four, and we're looking at them all right now. So you can see, this is probably like 1925. Well, there's still a few slides of some bodysuits that have been skinned here. This one looks like it's unfinished. Now, the other thing he would do is he would get mannequins, and he would wrap the skins, or put a mannequin inside the skin, and illuminate it from the inside, so that you could see the 3D tattoo. But these are still there in the medical museum in Tokyo University. Now check these out. So these are freshly peeled skins that are about to be preserved. He found a special way of preserving them so the ink wouldn't deteriorate and the skin would deteriorate. Kind of like tanning or curing a hide of a cow, but with designs of them. So it was pretty serious business. That's a beautiful one right there. Dragon, samurai. Pretty cool, right? This is a great one here. This one looked like it was just peeled off the guy. So that's his son. So his son has carried on the tradition. Now his son, who was friends with Horiyoshi II, who we saw before at a Tokyo, because his father was friends with Horiyoshi I, the sons had met. And now the father and the son doing the same thing in the tattooing and the skin preserving. So his son has actually collected an additional 20 skins to the original collection. They reckon the father inspected over 2,000 bodysuits in his career and took over 3,000 photos. Unfortunately, during the bombings of World War II, all the photos were destroyed in the fires and the bombings. But the skins survived because they were in a different building. So apparently he's still collecting skins now, but again, it's only the really special ones, and I'd like to go there myself and see them. So next time when I do, I'll take some photos while I'm in the presentation. So I'm going to talk a little bit about just some of the really basic symbols in tattooing, just for people who don't know. I might have to refer to my notes on this because my brain can only hold so much stuff. Okay. So the dragon. The dragon's the ubiquitous dragon. I mean, everyone loves dragons. They're a strong, powerful creature. They come from China originally. Now you'll see in China the dragons have four claws, or they have five claws. The five-clawed dragon is the imperial dragon, and only the emperor and the people of the royal house are allowed to display the five-clawed dragon. If you do that, otherwise, if you're a commoner, you pretty much get your head cut off, and that's the end of that. So most Chinese dragons are four claws. In Japan, the dragons are three claws. But they say that the dragon has the head of a camel, the horns of a deer, the scales of a carp, the paws of a tiger, the claws of an eagle, the eyes of a hare, and the ears of a bull. This is what makes a dragon. They apparently live and control rivers and lakes. The bigger the body of water, the bigger the dragon. You'll often see, not in this photo, but you'll often see dragons holding a pearl or a flaming pearl. And that pearl is what lets them ascend to heaven. It is the essence of the universe. It symbolizes spiritual perfection, wisdom, and it is also a good luck charm. There is the mythology that dragons can transform into human form and occasionally mate with a human. Apparently, Hirohito, the Emperor of Japan, traced his descendants all the way to a dragon princess in the early 1200s. As I was saying before, the dragon lived in the air and in the water, and so was impervious to fire, so was the symbol for the firemen because it helped them protect them from flames. The next one we have is the phoenix, or the hole. Now, the phoenix is basically a pheasant and a peacock kind of mixed together. And the five traditional colors that go with the phoenix are meant to represent benevolence, purity, propriety, wisdom, and gentleness. They're the messengers of the Buddhist angels, the Tenin, and they mark the start of a new era. They're a symbol of peace. Have you seen the lion dogs or the shishi before, also known as the foo dogs? The foo dogs, again, come from China, also in Korea. They're used to guard temples, usually Shinto or Buddhist temples. Occasionally they'll guard a tomb, but mostly temples. They're usually in pairs, with the female with her hand on a cup. If you see them in Chinatown, one's a cup and one's a ball. And the ball is called a tama. And the tama is basically a wish-fulfilling jewel that symbolizes the light and Buddhist wisdom that it brings and the power to grant wishes. The lion dogs repel evil spirits, and they would sometimes tattoo them on the bellies of pregnant women to protect the unborn child. They also say that the lion dogs were very staunch creatures, and sometimes they would throw the cubs off the cliffs, and the ones that could crawl back up to the top were worthy of being raised. Kind of like the Spartan thing, right? And we have the koi. Now everyone says, you know, the koi is, you know, played out, but it's not. The koi is an awesome, awesome design. And there's a reason. It came from China in the 1600s, and they were basically collected by the aristocracy as living flowers due to their variations in colors and shapes and patterns and designs. And now everyone in Japan and China and here, a lot of Asians and white people have koi fish in their ponds. But at the time, they were very much a noble fish. They're considered the king of the river fishes. Now, the whole story of the fish swimming over the Dragon Gate starts from a mythology in China with the Wumen Rapids, which is a series of five rapids. If the fish could get through these five rapids in the Yellow River and then climb the Longmen Falls, they would do what was called passing through the Dragon Gate. And by passing through the Dragon Gate, they would transform into a dragon and go up into the heavens. They were a symbol of... they're a masculine symbol, and in Japan they have a Boys' Day festival where you might have seen big streamers of koi fish that they let the wind blow through, and they celebrate this festival too. The samurai would also blow these streamers outside their house if they had a baby boy, because the fish is a very staunch fish. It's very strong. They say that if you catch it and you're going to cut it to eat it, it won't even flinch. You can just cut it in half and it'll just sit there. So we have the tiger. Originally the tiger's from China as well. There's no tigers in Japan. They reckon that Buddhism came to Japan on the back of a tiger, with the monks riding the tiger. Its strength and virility appeal to the samurai, and the samurai use it as their symbol as well. It fends off dragon, ill fortune, and disease, and they're often depicted with a dragon. Tigers are said to be the only animals capable of penetrating the bamboo thickets. You'll see the bamboo here. So they're often shown with bamboo in the designs. The falcon as well, a predatory bird, was revered by the imperial people for being regal and strong. Falconry was a pastime of the nobility, so the courage. These were often used as symbols of the samurai as well. Then we'll go through a few of the flowers, and that will be the end. Now, the botan, or the pam, is again the Chinese flower, and it's called the king of the flowers. It is one of Asia's most celebrated flowers. During the Edo period, many new colors and many new shapes, there's many different ways to draw these flowers from where they come from, were created in this time. They bloom in spring, and they symbolize regal power, wealth, good fortune, and luck. If you make a design with a peony and a shishi, you get what's called Karashin Botan, which is the king of the flowers, which is the peony, and the king of the beasts, is the Shishi. Here we have the lotus. Now the lotus is an important symbol in Buddhism because it rises above the mud to bloom. It basically represents the human capacity to transcend the world's impurities and rise above. So it's very much like the good rising from the mud. So a lot of the times you'll see in designs, you'll see like the Buddhist monk sitting cross-legged on top of a lotus bloom. Then we have momiji, which are maple leaves, these ones here. They come in red, green, and orange. And they're a seasonal flower. Obviously they fall in the autumn. And they represent the passing of things and the melancholy of the season as winter is about to set in. We have the kiku, or the chrysanthemum. Chrysanthemum, again, is a Chinese flower. It was very popular during the Edo period. It was cultivated for its ornamental beauty. The flower represents steadfastness and determination, and also the symbol of the emperor in Japan. It is still used on the Japanese passport as the imperial symbol. And last but not least, we have the sakura, or the cherry blossom. This is the most important flower in Japan, not just Japanese tattoo, but in Japan itself. They have the cherry blossom festival, which is the week in the year. It's the first flower to bloom in the spring. It lasts 3 days and then it dies. So when you go to Japan during this time, people will go out to where all the cherry blossom trees are and sit on the grass and eat their lunch and drink and celebrate. And the whole sky and the ground will all be full of cherry blossom petals. The samurai identified with the short life and the beauty of the cherry blossom due to their own short lifespan in battle. And the short span of beauty that the courtesan might have. So it very much represented just the shortness and the brevity and the beauty of life. It represents new life, spring, beauty, and it is the quintessential Japanese tattoo. So that's my presentation. I hope you liked it. And there you go.